Yes. Hello. Welcome to Round Ball Rules. I'm Scott McKinnon, joined by Robbie Thompson and Grace Gill. Guys, are you limped in here, it must be said, feeling a bit sore and sorry for yourselves after playing a fundraising tournament for the John Moriarty Foundation? Ice? What do we need down here
There's
for you
no
guys?
No such thing as a friendly tournament.
Right.
Okay. I think that's clear from the top. Yeah, there was a lot of sweat and tears given out on the field yesterday, and all for a good cause, the John Moriarty Foundation as well. So great fun, great day out. Was really
excellent
great day.
Yeah, yeah. Your hammies are just feeling it. That's it, right?
And Grace,
wasn't she?
No, absolutely.
Six, seven goals.
This is where I live now.
Now we can only talk about it because there'll be no reenacting anything for at least a week and several hundred dollars worth of physio.
All worth it though in the end. Now look, it was another controversial weekend of A-League, highly entertaining, but what caught your eye? Something different, weird and wonderful that stood out to you. Do you want to start, Grace? Yeah?
Yeah, the one for me was Zappa's near-death experience down at Amy Park post-match with this huge lightning strike. But my favourite part about this, John Aloisi hiding behind Zappa's like his life depended on it. He said, no, you go, Zappers. I'll be behind you here. Don't worry about it.
He's trying
terrifying.
To protect himself.
And thankfully, they're okay. But just the noise that came from that lightning strike was, it was huge.
Did you see the reaction of the seagulls then?
Yeah.
That all swore. It was like some sort
they
of
cloud something was going on.
Vortex
permanent
thing going on.
Amy Park there.
Exactly.
I just love the fact that Zappers almost got zapped. It just makes sense for me. What about you? Because I know you
his
love the dance floor.
Oh, sorry,
right, just, a seesaw.
Yeah, there we go.
what did you pick up on the weekend?
Yeah, Lockie Rose. Yeah. Breaking a move, I guess you'd say, and that this is all these nice cameras that we have everywhere now to see. And, you know, what I think this shows us, not only a bit of personality behind the player, because Lockie Rose is, you know, this hard-working footballer up front that's
on the desk, yeah,
just letting it all go. And there he is in front of the assistant coach. And I think the assistant coach, you know, Russell Latapi, would love seeing players relaxed before kickoff, not all stressed up and thinking, oh, no, you've got to be relaxed to give your best out on the field. And if that means breaking a move, well...
To be fair, he's got some pretty good moves as well.
He does. He does.
Apparently, Dwight York's not a fan of the music, though. He doesn't
really?
Like... Yeah. He made that clear in the interview that Dwight is not a fan of his,
well, that's why
of his playlist.
That's why
and the big headphones on as well, so
but
no one else can hear
it. Music in the dressing room is okay.
Yeah,
for sure.
Yeah,
okay. Because Dwight would have been a DJ back in the day,
sure.
I reckon, as well.
Maybe it's too tweaked up techno-wise. Anyway, Melbourne Derby. Let's get into the Melbourne Derby. Massive crowd. Which, first up, is awesome to see, right? Those pitches at the start. I mean, how good is that from both these sides to rock up for what was a pretty entertaining showdown, although you'd have to say Victory shot themselves in the foot big time, didn't they, Robbie, with their ill discipline?
Yeah, ill discipline. But this was just... I mean, the first half just had everything, didn't it? So many storylines, so... You know, the characters of the game, Nani, everyone wanted to be a hero, Josh Berlante... McLaren becoming the highest ever goal scorer in this fixture now. That's 10 derby goals for him. He goes past Bessart, Berisha. How about this for a corner routine? Victory will be furious.
Oh, yeah.
But to have the gall to try that in the derby and just say, look, we've worked on this in training. We're going to just tear them open and embarrass them with this corner routine.
Training
and they did it. Exactly.
It.
Brilliant.
It was great to see. And
I feel a little bit sorry for Josh on that second one there. Just because Aidan O'Neill was quickly in there and it's a bit lazy and he knows that he's arrived late, it's borderline. And the red's okay, but it was borderline for me. But no, look, red card, fine. The referee makes that decision. Berlante's off. And from that moment on, this derby was about, you know, we've had such a crazy 35 minutes with two goals. Berlante should have scored, should have given Victory the lead. And then after that, we just saw that City were too strong. City were not interested in the romance of a derby comeback.
Why would they?
In front of 23,000 Victory fans. They just went, we are too strong for this. You with 10 men now have no chance. And Victory gave it everything. Victory fought hard. They battled. But there was just that, with that steely confidence of City that they've shown so far in these first three matches of the season. It was impressive.
It was great. And you're right, after the red card, there was this real sense of composure from City, and although Victory threw everything at them,
they did.
It never really felt like City were losing control of the game.
Yeah.
And having that extra body out there, just...
Well, that was what changed it.
It did.
The extra man changed...
Yeah,
that's
So Nani was furious about that after the game. I don't know if you saw the interview where he basically blamed the ref for ruining the spectacle for all the fans. I mean, is that just trying to get that frustration out
Absolutely, because he gave away a penalty caught by VAR, and that was a penalty, no doubt about it. They're the words of a losing player who knows that it could have gone either way. Like, the ref could have said, Brillante, that's it. That's your last chance. Any more? And because they lost, that's what comes to Nani's mind and says, and he starts using things about spectacle
and the crowd, and we want him back.
But this is a competition. This is between two teams that want to win, that finished first and second last year. So spectacle and crowd and good for the show don't come into it
but
at that
still
level.
That passion from him, right?
Absolutely.
Which is great to see, don't you think? Like, it is this massive name that's come here. Yeah. You could see him in the contest as well, how much he wanted to get that side
He's
back in.
He's a professional.
He is. Yeah. And it's great to see for victory for the league.
But ultimately, as a marquee player, he wanted to do more in that game than what he did. And I think that comment was around the frustration coming through. That
exactly.
The expectation around a player like Nani to step into Melbourne victory, win a Melbourne derby game for them, that's what he would be thinking. That's what he would need.
So where is he? Where do you think he's at? I mean, do you like his contribution so far? Will he build into the season?
Yeah, absolutely. He'll keep getting better and better when he knows his teammates more, when he settles more and more into life in Melbourne as well, because those sort of off-field things are a factor. Mm. But also, his teammates, they know the name Nani. They're getting to know the person, and they also have to get to know the player. What runs he makes, where he passes the ball, all of that. I mean, he can adapt probably better than a younger player. That team will keep improving, no doubt about it.
I think he'll get better. I think we've seen some glimpses and patches where he's been really impressive, and you see his excellence, his quality. He's not there yet, and he will get there, to your point. His teammates will get used to him, the runs, the speed of play, those types of things.
But you don't want it to be a one-man show.
No.
I don't want it to be the Nani show where Nani just gets better and better, and that no one else in victory can actually play, and they just start kicking the ball in, because that will serve no purpose either. Yeah. They won't be able to do it if they're not a team. And Nani knows that. He's already looking to bring everyone else into the game and lift them off the pitch. So look, no problems with him.
We're getting to know his body too, which is ripped to shreds.
It's
not bad. I mean, Robbie, I don't know what you've got going on underneath there.
We didn't see too much of that yesterday at the John Moriarty kick-around.
City, on the other hand, 3 from 3. Who's going to stop them? They're looking rock solid. You'd think maybe losing the grand final last year is their huge motivation for them this year to come out and keep firing. But they look unstoppable at the moment, don't they?
Yeah, they look really steady, really in control.
Yeah.
I guess my one concern around that is if a team peaks too early, where do they go? And unless they just sort of keep building and building.
Well, is that what happened last year? Because they were tired at the end of last
season. They were, yeah.
And they had a good start as well.
Yeah,
they were very impressive as champions already from the year before coming in there. I think they showed a lot of strength there. They lost their captain in the warm-up. Scott Jamieson, who was playing out of position in central defence, pulled up with a groin strain. Whether that was planned or not, because Curtis Good hadn't played so far this season, he came in off the bench. And then all of a sudden in the warm-up, Curtis Good is thrown into the starting 11 in the centre of defence. There's still no Nuno Reis. So that's a big chunk of your central defence from last year. Last-minute changes, and they still showed that kind of confidence and strength. Bodes well, doesn't it?
Socceroos watch, J-Mac. I mean, 4 goals now, right?
Yeah.
Lecky looking good. I mean, are they a lot?
Lecky is spectacular.
Lecky's incredible.
Yeah.
He's really good
spectacular. I mean, I've never, honestly, I know he's older, an older player now, and probably the intensity and the pace of the A-League is not Bundesliga, even though the competition is great and there's very competitive matches. But he is just, I think, in some of the best form that I've ever seen him play, apart from the early years when he first arrived in Germany. He's awesome.
Playing with confidence, looking really slick out there. I'd say in terms of his actual quality on field, I'd say he's outplaying a player like J-Mac, with J-Mac stepping up to take the pens
and
set pieces and things like that. But I think Lecky is just astounding at the moment.
Playing in the centre of midfield in the derby as well. Yeah. New position for him, because normally he's out up on the left flank. But with the changes, Tilio coming in, Nabu up there wearing the captain's armband. So Lecky's in midfield. Looked like he'd played there all his life.
He's going to Qatar then.
Yeah,
absolutely.
So. Sure.
McLaren
no
as well, the
no
way he's going.
Yeah, McLaren
as well.
Yeah.
Because confidence for strikers is everything. You don't want a striker who's getting there and always getting in the right place, but not hitting the back of the net.
Yeah.
And for me, he scored 2 penalties, but Jamie's finish the week before where he stole the ball
off the opening day.
And then just dinked it over.
Yeah. He's in great form too.
Yeah. In great touch.
And you can see it. He's just kind of going, yes, come on, I'm scoring
and
goals.
And he just wants to
great.
Play in front of more away fans if he can find them. Yeah. That's all he's interested in. And that's, you know, good on him.
Well, their coach is pulling the strings as well. Paddy Cosnorbo doing a great job. And he is front and centre for the A-League's All Access. Check it out. Here's a taste.
As soon as that happens, boom.
Yeah.
You do it.
Yeah.
I want to be one of the best coaches in the world. I want the players to be the best versions of themselves.
Dale, coach, you good?
And the only way to do that is through time and effort. To avoid that one, because that would just go back.
Yeah.
And then he's in trouble. And people think I'm probably mad. But, you know, it's a small detail that makes you win or lose and successful. And this is the detail that we... you know, that we go through to, you know, to improve our players and our team to play.
It is so good, the A-League's All Access. It's been great to watch. It drops every Thursday. That's on 10 Play and Paramount Plus. Well worth a watch. How intense is Paddy Cosnorbo? Because, I mean, they got the win in round one, which was, we were on that game, weren't we? And there was pizza and there was time for a bit of celebration afterwards after getting some revenge, you know, in the grand final rematch. And he's like, nah, they got training on Sunday. What about, you know, can they let their hair down tonight? No, they've got training on Sunday. So he is all focused, wants to be one of the best in the world. And I guess he's getting results so far.
Yeah, we saw Lockie Rose dancing in the All Access the week before. We saw Charlie Austin singing with their headphones on. Yeah. I wonder if there's any of that
I don't think we're going to see that from PK, but no. I'm
really
interested.
Billy Joel or something.
I'm really interested to see the Paddy Cosnorbo episode for the point that you not only see what they are as characters in terms of their footballing lives, but as people too. And I think that's the really insightful part about it. So I'm super intrigued to see how this one comes across.
It has been really good. I wonder if you'll get any fire ups. I mean, that Charlie Austin stuff the other week. Sensational. Love that.
Yeah, brilliant to see it because people don't see it very often. But I've no doubt that happens in a professional changing room.
Of course. As we commented, it happens between us.
Yeah, exactly.
Walk out of here. What are you doing? Why did you say
what
that?
What was that throw in the fourth
exactly.
segment?
You idiot. All right. We talked about the huge crowd on the Saturday night. On the Friday night at Amy Park, it was a very small crowd. Hardly anyone there. I think 2,400 fans were there. That was Western United up against the MacArthur Bulls. I know you're very passionate about this. Robbie, your thoughts on talking about the crowd with these two, let's be honest, pretty much brand new teams in the competition. They've only been around a few years.
They are. They're two brand new teams. And for me, the first point of this is that they're two very good teams with very good coaches. One have just won the cup. And the other are defending champions. And I'm sick, honestly sick of hearing about fans, about crowd sizes. Fans are great. I love the scenes. When a club is doing the right thing and there is room for improvement, the clubs clearly need to do more about connecting with their fan bases. But Western United, for one reason or another, are playing not in where they're from. They're a Western Melbourne side. That's where they should be playing. They're playing all their matches still away from home. Part of their deal was, we're going to build a stadium, we're going to be there. Hopefully that stadium will arrive sooner rather than later and they can really get to work. MacArthur are in their third season. They are playing away in Melbourne. Yes, they haven't got a huge travelling support. Yes, they are only getting a couple of thousand at home, but they are a good side. And these things have to happen organically. And I agree there is room for improvement. And I agree that seeing a full house at Amy Park is fantastic on the derby, and seeing travelling fans for the Big Blue or the Western Sydney travelling, brilliant. Let it happen for these sides. Hart didn't always have fans, or Melbourne City. Now that they're getting, now success comes. And let's show a bit of respect instead for the players and the job they're doing. And let's not our first conversation be, there's going to be no one at that game. I felt bad for Western United last year when they qualified for the grand final at the end of an epic semi-final comeback. It was monumental.
That was huge.
And all anyone was saying in the general sphere of Australian football was, oh, the grand final is going to have no one at the grand final. Mm-hmm. It's like, that is not the player's fault. Don't ask Josh Riston ahead of the game against MacArthur, How are you guys going in terms of crowd numbers? He's up against Arzani playing for a spot in the Socceroos team. That's the discussion. Let's start talking about the football on the pitch. Let's make the football on the pitch and the discussions around the football on the pitch better, interesting. Get people to the grounds, yes, because they will come if this product is interesting. If people think, I want to see that matchup. I want to see, oh, these people are playing great football. Mm. Instead of, oh, there's going to be no one there. Oh, there's no one there. They're not doing enough. They're not getting into schools. The prices are outrageous. That's the club's problem. Yeah. It's the APL's problem. They have to show leadership. The clubs are losing money. Get fans in. It's your problem. It's not the football community's problem to worry about what MacArthur are doing for their fans. Their problem is to talk about what their team's going to do against MacArthur, how they're going to beat them, and support your own team. Enjoy your football. The football is good. Arnie said it was... The games that we're seeing are as good as some in Europe.
Yeah.
I agree with that. It's not a Clásico. It's not PSG versus Chelsea in the Champions League. Okay, but it is a good match of Dutch football. It is a good match of Belgian football, better than matches in Austria. And these are leagues that are supported, that have fully professional four divisions. You know, this is everyone here is pulling their hair out for no reason. Watch it. It's not that bad.
Yeah.
The footballers are great. They're busting their you-know-whats on the pitch to do it. The coaches spend all week thinking about it, and it's there. It's good. Get behind it. Stop talking about crowd sizes.
Look, I think it's a really good point, Robbie, and I think there does have to be a level of respect for these players who are really quality
No
players.
One knows the names of the players
no,
still.
I know. Still. And this is a problem. But the more they play and the more highlights we see, the more action. I mean, Arzani, for instance, I mean, that was... He had an unbelievable performance the week before, didn't he?
Yeah. So, yeah.
People
so there was
should,
expectation
exactly.
And it didn't happen. And that's
no.
a talking point
yeah.
in this game. So he was disappointing. Why? Because Josh Risden was up against
him,
and kicked seven
yeah.
shades of, you know, what out of
yeah.
him. That's a battle. Risden's
so
trying
then
to get on
is
that
it
plane.
On the clubs then to
the clubs,
try and...
Everyone has to do more. I'm
yeah.
not saying that... People are—they're just the focus is in the wrong place
yeah.
at the moment
yeah.
for
Look,
me.
I think there is a bit of a strategic question whether it's
there
the
is
club
absolutely
or whether it's
there
APL
is.
About
but this is leadership and boardrooms.
Is.
This
yeah.
is not fans watching the game
it
and
is.
Getting to the ground.
But the question can be around the infrastructure. Do those teams get put at a smaller stadium for a period of time?
Yeah,
create
absolutely.
That amazing atmosphere.
Well,
I'm talking a few thousand, and we know that a stadium with sort of 3,000-4,000, if that's packed out, that's a great atmosphere.
Absolutely,
and
it is.
Then
yeah.
people see that
Makes
and then
sense.
Come along to those games. So there's a strategic question around the management of the club, of the APLs, of how they make the best out of that product. But I agree with your point that the talking points need to be about the players, because Risden against Arzani on
yeah.
Friday night was spectacular.
Yeah.
He had
yeah.
an excellent game, and some of the quality that we saw from Western United in the first half
yeah.
was brilliant.
Yeah.
Jamie
mm-hmm.
Young again is,
yeah.
is having
yeah.
a
yeah.
wonderful
yeah.
season to
yeah.
kick things off. So there are these talking points that I think that needs to be the narrative more
yeah.
so around these empty stadiums. I think that's a bit of a shame.
I think another talking point is why Josh Risden was shifting furniture on game day and split his head open.
Yeah.
Unbelievable. Anyway, that was something else that we took away from that game, but he had an absolute blinder.
Yeah.
Let's have a look at some of the other results from over the weekend. And, well, that's how it started. Yeah, Western United, MacArthur, 1-1 draw there. The Jets, aren't they trucking along nicely? Only two games because that F3 derby was postponed because of the rain, but 3-1 over the Phoenix and the Wanderers unbeaten as well. You had Charlie Austin scoring his first goal for the Brisbane
oh, he had
Roar.
To, didn't he?
Well, he did big time after that. He had to deliver. We've spoken about the derby 2-2. This was the biggest controversial game of the weekend, you'd have to say. Adelaide United and Sydney FC, they put on four goals there at Allianz Stadium, but the controversy we'll dig into in a sec. And there was a bit of controversy pre-game with Perth ahead of that one with Bruno Fornaroli, but 2-1 the score against the Central Coast Mariners. So entertaining round of football. Let's get straight into, I think, the red card controversy, because it happened fairly early in that Reds game. Ibusuki, what are your thoughts on this? Because Broski called it the worst red card decision he's ever seen, and this is from a Sky Blues legend. Your thoughts on this?
Well, when you see it the first time, I probably saw it a little bit the same way as Carl Viet there.
Yeah.
The problem is, the rules referees are focusing on certain things, and every year referees have a new focus.
Yep.
And one of them is protecting player welfare.
Mm-hmm.
If you go into a challenge and you connect with another player with your studs raised, then the referee, we've seen the precedents, and we've seen a lot in Europe this season as well, if people are watching European red cards. There are red cards for that, for people kicking the ball, just making a pass.
Mm.
You kick it and your foot's raised and the person comes across to block. You catch them with your studs. It's different to a slide tackle where you can see just as much contact.
Yep.
And you can kick the legs out of someone. It won't be a red card. So this is an interpretation, probably gone too far. I mean, there's no doubt that there was no intent,
yeah,
which is not necessarily the point, but it was he won the ball, an accidental. It didn't even look that he had bent legs. He was pulling out of it. I mean,
but then,
on
then
every
VAR,
level, it was tough,
right? So then,
and there's VAR. So perhaps he should have gone and had another look at it instead of, because he never went and looked at the vision again.
Right. Well, that's
so VAR clearly said, look, he's connected with his studs raised,
yeah,
and the referee said, okay, well, that's enough for me. He was sliding through. He wasn't in control of his body. He couldn't stop. I understand it from that point of view, but what I understand a whole lot more, Grace, is that it's been rescinded.
It has. And that's the important outcome, albeit it puts Adelaide in a tough position, having to then play that game with a player down.
Yeah.
Look, I was calling this game with Simon, and at the time when it came through, we thought, oh, okay, there's a foul.
Yeah.
And then we saw the referee go to pull his card, and Simon was about to say there's a yellow card, and we saw
and
the
then
red.
And it was a different colour.
The look of bewilderment at each other.
Yeah.
But I think that's those initial responses. The general consensus is that, on glance, it wasn't a red card, and obviously VAR have made that determination, letter of the law, and you're exactly right, studs up. That's a red card. But the most important part now is that Ibusuki will be available to play at Cooper Stadium on Sunday, first home game for the Reds, and he'll be available, which is a good outcome.
He was sent off in the Cup as well earlier against Brisbane, I think, was it, in Adelaide, where Brisbane got over them. And there again, I think he was a little bit like, this is a little bit tough. That one's obviously very tough. I hope he doesn't feel that he has to change the way he plays.
Yeah.
Because that's what these rules tend to do. We saw it when they, you know, 30 years ago when they ruled out goalkeepers picking up the ball from a back pass. And so we had hundreds of free kicks, indirect free kicks in the box, because it takes a little while for everyone to get used to a new rule. Hopefully that new rule is not going to hang around.
I don't think Phil Moss knows that rule, because he picked up a couple of back passes
yesterday. He did, even from outside the box as well. It's a fair call. He was a bit of Jose Chilavert yesterday.
We've seen it in World Rugby as well, and they had a crackdown before the 2019 Rugby World Cup, and any contact with the head, you were seeing a red card or you're getting suspended. And you know, at the time, everyone's saying, well, you're ruining that World Cup, but I mean, it's just taken a while for everyone to lower the tackles. And look, it's still happening, but they've also got to be conscious of people and lawsuits and, you know, concussion and all the long-term effects. It's player welfare they're looking
out
for.
Because you don't want players flying into challenges and saying, I got the ball, because you can get the ball, and also quite deliberately.
Yeah.
Exactly, and you can quite deliberately. So there has to be some common sense.
Mm.
We saw it with Jan Sass, who slipped in his challenge and could have done serious injury because he was going at pace.
Yeah.
But Ibusuki, I mean, it wasn't at pace. But if you accept that it's a foul, first of all, and Simon says could have been a yellow. So if you're accepting that, it means that you've seen that there's contact with studs. And so the next logical step is, well, that's a red. Did Caceres have a cut? I think he had a cut just below his knee.
Right.
I think they put there was a bandage going on and stuff. Yeah. So, and the referee's looking at that and saying, look, he's got a gash on under his knee.
Mm.
So there has been contact. The question is, a bit of common sense.
Yeah,
a bit of common sense.
That's it. And you know, they've turned it over. The problem is that they're never going to get their points back. I mean,
but they did brilliantly.
They did, you know.
Carl Viet knows a little bit more about his side now as well.
Yeah.
And for Carl Viet moving forward, okay, we've played an hour more,
with
10 men, and we've shown how to do that, and we've scored twice.
Yeah.
And we've clawed this back
and
against
Craig
a good
Goodwin
side.
Too. He's looking the goods. Again, if we're on Socceroo watch, are you getting him on the plane? Are you a good one?
Look, I think he's done enough for me. I think he's been really good form at the moment.
I don't, honestly, since I've been back, I'm not sure why there's too much of a question mark about it. In terms of, I mean, I think he was one of the best players in the league last year.
Yeah.
In part of an Adelaide side that he was so crucial in his leadership, in his play, in the quality of his play. I mean, his left foot is gold. Yeah. He can take corners, he can take free kicks. That's important at a World Cup as well.
He stepped up and took a pen against Peru as well.
Like, experience, yeah. Exactly. No problem for me.
All right, let's continue on the controversy theme, shall we? This is to do with Bruno. Do we want to talk about Bruno? No. You know the song. But look, this is an Instagram one. Don't we love a bit of social media? Fun and games. So, yeah, they put out the team, and then someone goes, Bruno is out. Why? Because of injury. And he's written back going, no, 100% fit and ready. Wrong information, with a bit of a wink, which was then taken down, wasn't it, Robbie? You said that he deleted that one.
Yeah, that one was deleted.
So what's going on with this? He's obviously furious that he's not part of this touring team.
You know, and that's a player's not a right, certainly not a right to do it. Well, okay, first of all, we're calling this game. Me and Macca are calling this game, and we see this. And as commentators and journalists on a match, you start sending a few messages. What's going on? Where's Bruno? What's happened? We heard, there was a Zadkovic press conference during the week. Could Bruno be dropped? Has Bruno been dropped or is there a problem? Macca's on the phone to all former teammates around the country, finding out what's been going on. Macca starts fielding phone calls from Perth saying, this is what's happened. This,
And, injury?
And so we have to be
no
careful.
Injury.
We have to be careful. You're hearing a lot of mixed reports. And what clearly, if Bruno is saying he's not injured, then there's a communication breakdown.
Yeah.
Now, that communication breakdown, we heard, could have happened the day before they left. You know, that there are all sorts of things going on within a football side. And normally this is not aired in public and certainly not on Instagram.
No.
In the minutes leading up to a game. I don't think it would have affected the squad too much. I think that what affected
well,
the squad
didn't.
Has
they
probably...
They got a win.
Exactly. But that the controversy and everything, they wouldn't have been aware of it.
Mm.
It would have happened the day before at training or the day before or whenever there was a blow up in training. But as soon as Bruno sent that message, it's going to be, I looked at his stats, made sure I had his stats all right for the game. So it was 34 goals in 70 games or 72 games. So fantastic record, one every two. Has he played his last game for Perth? There's got to be, they're going to have counselling if they want to fix that rift.
Big time.
For me.
I mean, Zadkovic came out afterwards and said maybe his account got hacked, but it was pretty clear.
I don't know.
Well, he deleted it.
That's
he
your
deleted
fallback
it.
Response.
Of course it is, but he didn't really want to talk about it either. I mean, that's a big goal.
They got the win. Asbel played well instead of him up front.
Where does he end up then? Let's not forget he played for the Socceroos recently too.
Yeah. And he's a great player. He's a great player with a fantastic record. He's 35 now.
Yeah.
He's had ankle problems and a couple of little injury issues over the last few months. So where is he at physically? Is he the player he was when he first arrived at Perth or at Melbourne City or at Genoa because he's had a fantastic career.
With that exchange on social media, and these are the pitfalls of social media, he's not going back to Perth. He's not playing another game for Perth. Sort of speculation of this whole
that's
situation,
how you read it.
And understandably, Zadkovic doesn't want to talk about that because the team's just picked up their first win. And
of
again,
course.
This is the frustration
that's
where
all
that's
you
the
get.
Narrative
yeah.
around
yeah.
this. You
exactly.
want the focus to be around Perth, and that's a great result for them to get the first 3 points of the season.
At least talking about this is sports related.
That's
because
true.
You are talking about your number nine who can't play. It's not how many people are sitting at Macedonia Park as opposed to HBF Park. La, 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 la. Let's get the narrative where it needs to be.
What happened to the Central Coast in that game? I was expecting them to really come out and do something special. Garen Kuol was back in there. You've got guys like Cummings trying to have a crack and make it into this Socceroos side. Disappointing showing for them in their first game on at home.
Yeah, I was hoping that they'd, perform better than they did at home in that first game. Sammy Silvera, fantastic goal, 2-2 for him.
Yep.
But that was really their only chance of the first half, nearly of the entire match. And there's Azubel setting up the first goal for Gio Colli, just his second in the A-League. Good play down the right from Williams. Great save, Vukovic, if you want to. There's someone who was in Peru two months ago or in Qatar with Australia against Peru. And then that mistake. Mariners have a couple of issues at the back. They have new players playing in the centre at the back and they look good and bad in alternate moments of the match. McInniff second in two for him. and right place, right time. But Mariners, not no energy, not enough until the last few minutes where they threw a bit at Perth. But the talking point there is Perth. They were under the hammer. Yeah. Everyone was hammering them left, right and centre after those first two games. And they came out and showed, got a win. Great.
All right. Let's have a look at some of the fixtures coming up then for this weekend. And plenty to get excited about. Western Sydney Wanderers and the Jets, two teams unbeaten so far. Raw and Victory. I mean, Victory, geez, they'll be desperate for a win. That's two games that they've lost coming into this one. So they'll be super pumped up for this one. Central Coast have a chance to hit back against Western. MacArthur and Sydney FC. Now, this should be an absolute cracker. You've got the Australia Cup winners. Sydney FC are looking to get on the board as well with a tasty victory there. But that should be a juicy one, don't you reckon, Robbie? I'm looking forward to this one. A derby.
It is. It is a Sydney derby. I don't think you can have too much doubt about that.
No.
There are two Sydney clubs who are going at it. There was an original Sydney derby. Now we've added a third club into the mix. It's a similar situation to what's happening in Melbourne with Western United. MacArthur are undefeated.
Mm.
They've shown that
under
defensively
Dwight.
They're strong. Exactly, under Dwight. Undefeated under Dwight. And that's going to be a cracking game. We've still got Socceroo Watch. Two games left for these guys to show what they need to do. MacArthur would like to get back to winning ways as well, I think. And Sydney can't afford to drop too many points. There's pressure on. They've had a couple of good results after losing the Big Blue.
Mm.
And there's still pressure on Stevie Corica and his side. But the new boys there are looking good. Lolly and Mac are looking very good.
Yeah.
They're looking pretty special. And I think as well, sitting fourth and fifth on the ladder respectively between these two teams, either side is just looking to get that little jump up.
Yeah.
And so there's so much importance on this result, on this match, and either team building on what they've done so far this season.
And Adelaide on Sunday, that should be a good one.
I think that'll be a great game, and particularly with Perth coming off their first win, and Adelaide their first game at home at the newly redeveloped Cooper Stadium. I think that's going to be an absolutely cracking match.
Mm. Yeah, and Adelaide, both of those two sides showed great character at the weekend.
Excellent.
Varying degrees of quality over the 90 minutes, but great character.
Yep.
And there'll be more of that in Adelaide.
Okay, well, it all starts on Friday night, and Grace and I will be bringing you that. Are you calling that one? Not Friday night. Oh, look out.
Oh.
Needs to ice his body after football still. But two teams undefeated. The Wanderers are looking pretty good, aren't they? They've got a whole new team, 19 fresh faces. They're unbeaten. Marco Redown, you're liking what you're seeing from them with their new recruits?
Yeah, they've been sort of refreshingly good to watch, and I think it's a really lovely turnaround for the team. And Marco Redown has spoken a lot about the culture and the buy-in from the community, and I think that's what the team's needed for a couple of years now.
Oh, big time.
It feels as though
they've spoken about it previously, but you need to actually get that buy-in, right?
It feels like the buy-in is there from the players,
and
I think I can see that on the field, and I can see that in them playing the style they're playing, producing the results they are.
Yeah.
So I think, that's going to be a huge game to open the weekend.
Yeah.
Newcastle.
Marcelo Kripic looking good too, isn't he?
Absolutely. Yeah. No, Marcelo's a big one.
Yeah.
Amalfitano in the middle of the park, he's got that, you know, that European experience, and is not afraid to pull out a professional foul when one is necessary, which I think Marco Redown appreciates as well from his place on the bench. Word on Newcastle then as well, because they've only played twice, but they've won both of them.
Yeah.
The first one was down to 10 men with that Mikkel Tadze winner in the last minute against Perth. Then they showed it from the outset with a great 3-1 victory over Wellington. Pappas, we haven't seen that dominant Pappas ball maybe yet, but we've seen some lightning transition play. He's brought his players in. We talk about 19 new faces at Western Sydney. There are new faces everywhere at Newcastle as well. And Sotirio, Bahaja, Piscopo, you know, Dartsmelia, the B2. Becker,
because we're getting on the
Georgian.
Double Becker bus, isn't that what we're calling it? You get on the double Becker bus. He scored
an cracker.
Absolute cracker. Here we go. Let's have a look at this one, because
this was a beautiful
one.
Yeah, and I loved his movement sort of in creation. We knew exactly what he was doing, and he was the architect behind this strike, and wasn't it just a delightful hit?
Because Ollie Sale is a good keeper.
That was
tough. Look, I think he's still got room for improvement. He's really young as well. I mean, Mikkel Tadze is young, even if he looks a bit older.
Yeah.
but Dartsmelia is young. He's settling in. This is a big move for them to come from Georgia,
massive
to Lokomotiv Tbilisi, and come to Newcastle. These are big life changes.
Huge.
focus on your football, great, but he's just going to get better and better, I think, because I wasn't... Jury was a bit out for me on his first game.
Yeah.
I think he drifted in and out of the match and was a bit lightweight. Maybe that goal will give him the confidence to go on with it.
First game I did at Newcastle last year when Mikkel Tatsi was there. There were some Georgian fans in the crowd. They came and found me after the game and they were just waxing lyrical about Becca Mikkel Tatsi. They're just like, oh, you've got a good one here. You've got a really good one. They were at every game last year with the Georgian flag. So now they can double their Georgian flag capacity to get them in. But I think it's great. And the community's getting behind them. The other two guys in there, Renaud Piscopo and Sotirio as well. I mean, how much of a change have they made and just helped that Newcastle team from what you've seen so far?
Sotirio and Bahaja, we know they're flyers.
Yeah.
They're going to suit that fast transition game that Pappas likes. Piscopo pulling the strings, having arrived, he and Sotirio arriving from Wellington. McGarry was on the score sheet. Him and Jenkinson as well, let's not overlook their influence as fullbacks. They didn't have the full... speaking to Arthur Pappas, I'm not sure the fullbacks played as much of a role as he wanted them to last year. He went and brought these two guys in to put that pressure on, to overlap, to get crosses in. And when you've got those flyers up front, I mean, they have the structure now that... and the players, the personnel in the positions they want to have the season that we thought they were going to have last year.
Yeah. Either way, like every time you watch Newcastle play, it's exciting. Yeah. From my experience.
Well, it has been so far.
Anyway,
as well.
So far, let's hope they can do it again. But the Wanderers rock solid at the back, so wait and see. Poll time. Here's the poll for this week. And it's back to Melbourne City. It is Melbourne City, currently unbeaten in the A-League. Men, when will their first defeat come? Phoenix this weekend. Let's not forget they beat them in the Australia Cup round of 16 before the calendar year in the final series, or it just won't happen. What are we thinking about City?
I left my crystal ball.
Oh, get it out. Yeah, yeah.
Man. You know what? I'm going to say before the calendar year.
Yeah?
Yeah. Yep, I am.
The question is just too impossible to answer.
Well, you got to throw something in there.
Maybe could happen this weekend.
This weekend?
Yeah, why not?
Okay.
Anything can happen.
I reckon
before calendar year
as well, because the Socceroos will get through the group. And
there's not that many games left before the end of the calendar year.
No, there's not. It's
two more
approaching, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah. Then maybe one after. Are they going to lose in the next three games? Basically your question.
Yeah.
Maybe.
It's kind of a question. It's a bit different.
Yeah, it was out there, but I see where you're going with that. Yeah. All right, it is time for us to take a break. Up next, we're going to talk Matildas, and we're going to catch up with one of their absolute superstars, Mary Fowler. Welcome back to Round Ball Rules. We're going to shift our attention to the Tillies because it's all getting very real for them all of a sudden. The draw was held for the World Cup on the weekend. What are we making of that draw? Because they picked out, you know, we always talk about this group of death, right? Is it in your eyes? Ireland, Canada, we know are very good, and Nigeria. Your thoughts on that, Grace?
Yeah, well, first of all, super exciting to know the fixtures, to know the games.
Yep.
And that opening game, Australia, Republic of Ireland, is sold out, which is unbelievable. And
that's
awesome. But in terms of it being a group of death, look, I don't think it is a group of death. I think it's a tough group. I think Canada, we know that they're a world-class side. But I think realistically, those games against the Republic of Ireland and Nigeria, they should be teams that... I have such hope and expectation in our Matildas that they should be winning. And I think Canada are very beatable. So when we speak about this group of death, I don't entirely agree that that's the right narrative around the Matildas games coming into the World Cup.
So we played Canada recently, two-game series. What was it, 1-0 and 2-1? So it was quite close.
Yeah.
I guess people are going, oh, geez, we played Ireland at the back end of last year and went down, which was a massive upset. So is that maybe where some of that narrative around group of death has come from?
Maybe. I mean, the fact that Ireland, I mean, there are a lot of Irish here. There are a lot of people with Irish heritage all over the world as well. So they're going to have good support as well. But perhaps, I mean, this is their first major tournament.
Yeah,
this is their first real achievement for them. They did it right at the death in the last second of qualifying. Fantastic for them. Nigeria probably have a little bit more footballing history.
Mm.
But African football sides in the women's side of the game are still finding their way forward in the world, to be really able to contest at the highest level for the moment. So for me, it's between Australia and Canada to get out of that group. I'm very confident we'll get out of the group, which is, you know, a starting point. From then, who we play in the second round, will we make then go on to quarterfinals? Because at the moment, if we finish second behind Canada in the group, it'll be the European champions, England, if they finish top of their group, if all things go, you know, the way they should. So that could be a tough second round match.
Yeah.
I think there's a lot of hope that, you know, the Tillies could make the quarterfinals. And if they can make the quarterfinals, well, then anything can happen. Yeah. We saw it at the Olympics, you know. It all comes down to who's right on the day. And for me, so if we can make the quarterfinals, then it's game on.
Look, I think it's a World Cup. Any game, any group is going to be hard at home. But when you look at sort of the rankings, obviously Matildas have recently dropped down to 13th. You put as much weight as you want on these FIFA World Rankings as you like. Yep. Republic of Ireland sitting at 24th, Nigeria at 45th, and Canada at 7th. So if you take that into consideration as well, the history with Republic of Ireland, the result last year, the Matildas are a better football side.
Of course, there were a couple of freak goals. Yeah,
they are. We saw the Republic of Ireland defeat Scotland in sort of heartbreaking scenes for Scotland to qualify.
So
they'll have a lot of momentum. They'll have a lot of support behind this group. But in terms of our individual quality in our Matildas up against the Republic of Ireland quality, we've got them. We've got them sorted.
So
I don't think it's exactly a group of death as it's been touted, but I think it's going to be a tough group because it's a World Cup and it should be.
Of course, every game.
Home soil could make the difference.
Yeah, you know,
playing at home with the crowd. If we can get all our girls back on form, you know, injury free for that run in, just having them all here and playing at home in front of full houses, that can just make the difference.
Dial it up a bit more. All right, let's check in with one of the Matildas superstars now, Mary Fowler, who's joining us all the way from Manchester, where she's plying her trade. Mary, thank you so much for your time. We're just chatting about, you know, the draw on the weekend. So does that put it into a bit more of a sharper focus for you?
It is. It feels a lot more real. I mean, now you can, you know, smallen your focus, you know, like you can narrow it in a lot more. And I think we've been very fortunate to have versed Ireland and Canada recently. So we have an idea of, you know, what we're up against. It doesn't, you know, make it any easier because we do have a tough group. But I think it, you know, I'm really excited and I'm really confident in the group that we have and us being able to go up against them and compete really well and win. And so I'm very happy with the group we've got in. I was excited to get Ireland because of my Irish background. So, I mean, for me personally, I'm really happy with the group that we've got and I'm very confident in us going out there.
Mary, you mentioned Ireland and obviously with your dad being Irish, how do you feel about lining up against them in the opening match of the Women's World Cup next year here in Australia?
I feel really lucky. You know, I was watching the draw live with some teammates of mine and I said to them, I really hope I get Ireland. That would be really special. And then we got Ireland and I was like, oh, like it couldn't have been any better. You know, it's such a once-in-a-lifetime thing to have a World Cup at home and to be able to verse Ireland and, you know, feel, you know, because I feel a connection to, you know, my background, where my dad's from, where my mom's from, to be able to, you know, represent Australia and verse them, for me, would be very special. And I'm really, really happy that we got them.
Mary, after some mixed results coming into the last international window, how important was it to get those wins over South Africa and Denmark?
No, it was very important for confidence and it's what we've been needing for some time now. And I think because we still have, you know, 8 months or so to the World Cup, it's nice that we've, you know, turned a page and we're now, you know, back on winning terms. And so I hope that, you know, moving forward, we keep on performing like this and keep building on, you know, what we've just done. But it's been so important for us to get some wins. Almost, you know, you almost forget how it feels and how important it is to have that. But I think now that we do have that, the team has a lot more belief in what we can do, and that will only get stronger the better we perform until the World Cup.
It's Indigenous Football Week here in Australia. How important is this week and the initiative for young Australians?
I think it's really important. I mean, I think the theme this, you know, year being partnerships for success, I think it just highlights how, you know, how much impact people can have when they work together to change lives. And I think, you know, there's football is such a transformative sport, and there's so many, you know, ways it can change your life by participating in it. So I think, you know, for being able to open doors for, you know, kids that are, you know, a bit less fortunate to take part in the sport, I think it's really important.
Mary, could you tell us a little bit more about the John Moriarty Foundation? Because it is so much more than just the sport, isn't it?
So the John Moriarty Foundation, they, you know, use football as a way to, you know, improve the lives of Indigenous kids. And, you know, it's, they train these kids. He has maybe 2,000, over 2,000 kids now. And I think the focus is, it's not necessarily just to get players to become elite footballers, but I think it's more to just help their well-being, and they improve, you know, participation in school through this. And so I think it's more to open a pathway that wasn't previously there for Indigenous kids. And yeah, I think it's it just goes to show how much, you know, change football can have on these kids' lives.
Mary, thanks so much for your time, and we cannot wait to see you down under very soon.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Well, there she is. And yeah, she mentioned the John Moriarty Foundation, which is terrific. You guys took part in a game yesterday.
You did six games.
Six games. And managed
five.
To...
too many.
Yeah, okay. But you made the big one, right? You made the final. But how special was the day? Here we go. You guys all in action. First question, why wasn't I invited? That's what I'm spewing about. But Macca McBreen putting it in there. How did you enjoy it?
Yeah, it was an excellent day. It was a really, really well-run day. A great turnout, some really good corporations there, and obviously for just a wonderful cause. How about this play here? What a beautiful pass there. What a combination between the two of us there, Robbie Thompson.
Yeah, it looks like it's in slow motion.
Yeah, we might need to speed that one up a bit. But no, it was excellent, and we'll be talking about it for weeks and feeling it for weeks because, boy, I am sore today.
Exactly, but what a great day. There is John Moriarty, who was called up to the Socceroos, never in the end got to play for the Socceroos. Jada Wyman, the Sydney FC goalkeeper, who's the goalkeeper that set a new record for clean sheets last year, an Indigenous footballer as well. Shadeen was there, who's just signed on for, and we came up against her, a fantastic footballer. She's alumni from the John Moriarty Foundation. It's so great for the Indigenous kids to be playing football. Like we heard, it's not just about the football, but for me to anchor the sport in Australia. We've seen Aboriginal athletes are such fantastic athletes. They've got so much attachment to this country. To get them playing football, more of them playing football, we know they'll be just fantastic, give us so many more options all the way through to the national team.
Look at the AFL, for example.
Exactly.
I mean, some of the amazing plays, they're just so creative, the things they can do with the football. So, yeah, it'd be great to see more of that in the round ball game, that is for sure. All right, well, let's have a look at some of the fixtures that are coming your way on Network 10. And we've got the Matildas coming up against Sweden, 2 o'clock in the afternoon. That should be a ripper. And then Matildas against Thailand on the Tuesday.
That's me and Grace calling both of those ones in Melbourne and Gosford. So if you're there, get your tickets, get along, let's fill the stadium. Sweden, they're the Olympic gold medalists. I mean, that's a huge
silver medalists behind Canada. But that would be a real litmus test for the Matildas coming up against Sweden, European powerhouses. So that will be a fantastic game down in Melbourne.
And what about the coach too? I mean, he's a Swede, so that should be quite interesting too.
Yeah.
They have much intel on them.
Exactly, inside running, fingers crossed.
Okay, and then let's check out some of the fixtures for the A-League coming up this weekend. As we touched on, Western Sydney Jets, the Raw, Victory, Central Coast and Western, MacArthur and Sydney FC, Adelaide back in Adelaide up against Perth Glory coming off a win, and then City. Can they keep it going, keep this roll going and make it 4 wins from 4 starts? Should be a ripping weekend. Cannot wait to have your company over the weekend, guys. Thank you for your company here. it's time to go and get in your ice baths and chill out after your footballing.
Thanks, Scott.
Straight off the physio.
Yeah, cheers, good Scotty. Stuff. All right, thank you, guys. Bye for now.